Journey with Judy. Honest, open, transparent. It's hot.
There's no such thing as perfect people. There's no such thing as a perfect life. So come as you are, broken and scarred. Lift up your heart and be amazed and be changed by a perfect God.
Good morning. Thank you for choosing to Journey with Judy. And I got Dave back in the studio with me. I had fun with Melissa last week, but you know what, Dave? I'm a creature of habit, and I'd rather look over there and see you. I will not tell Melissa. I promise I will not. But anyway, thanks for choosing to be with us again this Sunday morning. It is the third Sunday of Lent. We're keeping track of that because just like our New Year's resolutions, we have this little point in time in 365 days where we can carve out 40, where we go into the desert, we look at who we are, where we've been, where we want to go, and we start like just taking inventory of like the stuff that absolutely has got to go. And in my house, I'm thinking the four children I gave birth to have got to go because I have absolutely no credibility in my house whatsoever, Dave. Right now, just let me get you up to speed. My son Chandler, who is 18 years old, a senior in high school, is making that life decision about where he wants to go to college. And I have absolutely nothing to say about it, and neither does Bob, because like they say, you didn't even go to school. That's what they say. You didn't even graduate. I'm pretty sure you dropped out of eighth grade. You didn't even go to college, plus you wanted to be a boy. Now, most of those things are very, very true. The most truest statement is the fact that I did want to be a boy until I was 20, but we'll say, I did. I always wanted to be a boy, Dave. And you know what? I look like such a boy that everyone thought I was a boy, so they would say to my mom, like, what's your son's name? And I would just tell her to go with it. And there was so many times I would be with my brother and then he would just introduce me as Tom or some other name. Really. So anyway, that has nothing to do with my opening story. But the fact is we are fighting a lot in our house right now because Chandler is not seeing things from the perspective that, you know, we're seeing things from. And his perspective is the only perspective because Bob and I are dismissed for the fact that we didn't go to college. Well, but here's what I love about God is that I was stirred to look back because I kept saying to the kids, you know, I did go to school. I did graduate eighth grade. I graduated high school. As a matter of fact, I did go to school. But then I started thinking that I didn't finish college, Dave. I did drop out due to the lifestyle and the choices that I was making at that time in my life. It was just that was the beginning of the spiral for me. But I've been telling people for a lot of years that I have an associate degree. And no one's ever checked on this, and I'm here to be honest, open, and transparent and tell you, anyone who's ever interviewed me, I've been lying right to your face because I do not have an associate degree, Dave. I knew I was a little short of it, just a little bitty short, but I didn't know how short. So I called the college, the community college that I went to. Brookdale Community College in New Jersey. I did most of my damage there in New Jersey, and that's why I had to move to the state of Illinois. But anyway, so I called there, and this woman, she was like, when did you come? You know, when were you here? And I said, it's really just a blur to me. And she goes, well, could you give me, like, some idea, like, what year? You know, and so, of course, I'm saying my married name instead of my maiden name. I was not married then, Dave. So I'm wondering if this woman thought I even really did ever attend this college. This was recently. Recently, I made this phone call because a lot of times, Dave, I'm looking for some sales situations for me that maybe I could, you know, step back into the workforce and sell. And everything's asking for an associate degree. And it's time that since I'm, you know, trying to be a preacher and honest, open, and transparent, it's time I stop lying about the fact that I really don't have a degree. And so I'm so excited to show you, Dave, this is my proof. This is a transcript. This is proof that says I went to college. And I'm so excited about it because I keep saying to my kids, like, did I happen to tell you? I went to college. And one of the things in my house is the kids have to have a certain GPA. And so now, unfortunately, I did have that GPA when I started college. But as I did mention, I did kind of spiral downward. And so, no, I did okay. Like, I was just under a 3.0. Well, of course, my kids say, Mom, it was a community college, and they totally are dismissing me. But anyway, the point is I am looking back on this time in my life, and this was back in 1984. And I'm wondering, like, why did I start something and not finish it? Like, what was the disconnect that I set out to do this thing, but yet it never actually came to pass? And you know what? Here's what I do know is just months before that, unexpectedly, I was a senior in high school, and I was making those plans like my son is making right now. You know, and of course I keep saying to him, I could die right now. And then Campbell's like, that wouldn't necessarily be a bad thing. No, this is how these kids talk to me, Dave. But really, it was senior year of high school, my mother died. And I had plans, much like my son, to go to a college and play a sport at the next level. And I had these visions of grandeur, and they were all stopped quite abruptly on March 17th when my mother died. And so I ended up going to this community college. I ended up getting, you know, mixed up with the wrong people. And I ended up trying to numb my pain. And to make a really long story short, I didn't finish what I started. I didn't complete that which I set out to do. And so, but everything is a blur. So I can just compartmentalize that, Dave, and put it in the past. But what I've noticed about in 1984 to now, which is 2015, is that there are just three things that I didn't do then that stopped me from where I was supposed to be going and getting to. And I'm still guilty of those three same things in 2015. And I got to change that, Dave. Right? We got to change that. We got to change the cycles of defeat. So stay with me. We're going to talk about what you should do, what you could do, and what you would do if you were journeying with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. We will be back. I turned 49 years old, and part of my kids' requirements are to write me a letter, and my man did as well. And my pride tells me today to read to you what my man wrote. His letter said, "You are loving, kind, forgiving, nice, smart, honest, pretty, devoted, driven, faithful, friendly, generous, giving, humorous, independent." Can you tell we were having a big old fight? Because he's groveling. This is a groveling birthday letter. And about 12 more things, I think he went in alphabetical order and took this right off the internet. But anyway, okay, so the kid who said, "You have taught me more than anyone ever could, but you could have done it in 100,000 less words," was Chandler.
Was that the first one?
Chandler, that's the first one. "You have taught me," that was Chandler. Okay, the second kid who said, "Wow, we have been through a lot together, the nagging, the punishments, the fights," that was Carter. Carter told me that from Arizona. The third kid who said, "You are so annoying, I'm stopping the letter now because I'm not competing with my siblings to make you cry," Campbell. She's gotten so sassy since last year. She is so sassy. Yes, she is. Kennedy was the final. "You cry too much. You're always mad about something." And Kennedy and Campbell both called me a hag. Happy birthday, hag. Chandler and Carter both, and Bob, all started their letter, "Dear Judy," like as if I'm not their mother. And so anyway, on a brighter note, I have to say that even though those four segments that I pulled out were totally disrespectful and rude, by the same token, they were absolutely honest, open, and transparent. And what I have to say about the other thing about Campbell, she started off by saying, "Happy birthday, hag. Thanks for holding me to the highest standard." So I have to grab that. And see, that's the humble part of her. And the pride says to say all these icky things about me. Chandler didn't only tell me that I was his greatest supporter, recruiter, chef, lecturer. I guess I lecture too much. But anyway, so Chandler said a lot of really beautiful things. I don't need to read them all. You know, Carter reiterated some very inappropriate things that we have fought about over the years. But he did say, "I continue to grow and understand the person I've become, and I can't thank you enough." So that was a beautiful letter. Kennedy's was really awesome because somewhere in there, she always says, like, "We don't have the relationship that I know you wish we had," which is really true. But on a brighter note, Kennedy and I are making huge progress over text and email. We communicate way better over text and email. So anyway, thank you, thank you, thank you to my children for these beautiful letters. Thank you to the people that called me or texted me to wish me a happy birthday. And I'm still so full of myself and so full of pride that I'm wondering what this text message meant when it said, "Happy birthday. I hope you get all that you deserve." Because here's the deal. If I got all that I deserved, I would not be on the other side of this microphone. I would not be asked. I would not. Dave, I don't even know where I'd be, Dave. I think in a loony bin or in jail. But here's the deal. When it comes to pride and humility, the fact of the matter is my kids could have legitimately allowed their pride to keep them from doing the very thing that would have been so important to me. They could have justifiably withdrew their love and affection and concern for me as their mother, because that's what pride does. It keeps you from blank. It keeps you from doing so many things that you should be doing. And here's the other thing about pride, is it causes you to do so many things that you wouldn't do if you were a person of humility. So the deal about pride, I said it in the beginning, is pride has I as its center, much like sin. I is right there in the center when it comes to being full of yourself. And you know what people say, like, you know, pride is a good thing when it comes to like being happy about your kid. When Avery does something, David, you talking about Avery or you being proud of Angela, that's not the kind of pride we're talking about. We're talking about the very pride which is the greatest enemy of anybody. Like, we got, this is something that we absolutely have to get rid of. This is the kind of pride that keeps you, pride is the thing that keeps you from like celebrating another's success or initiating an apology when you know you're 100% wrong or 5% wrong. It's the thing that keeps you from arguing your point long after there isn't a point, Dave. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Do you ever do that with Angela where it's like it's over and done with and let's just regurgitate it some more? Exactly. I forgot where I was going with this, so let me beat you over the head some more, the big time slap down. This thing is what keeps you from admitting that you're either lost, like my man will never say, hi, I'm lost, how do I get to where I'm going, or admitting that you're weak, admitting that you need help, or admitting that you have no idea how to get what it is that you need, but you desperately need something. And your pride is the resounding thing within you that says, no. I got this. Like, I totally got this. I'm bigger, I'm better, and I control everything. And that's just such a false sense of reality. Here's the last thing that it does, and maybe the most important thing that pride does, is it keeps you from being honest with yourself and with others, right? It stops you from learning new things because you want to believe that you know it all. Like we say in our house, you're a Kia. Chandler says, Dad is such a Kia. Bob says, Chandler is such a Kia. It's a know-it-all, K-I-A. Oh. Know-it-all. They all, and it's so funny because what you hate about somebody is what you love about somebody, Dave. And the things that drive me nuts about my kids are those very behaviors that I absolutely passed on to them through childbirth. They're in my genes. It's like it was a gift that I served up to them, and it was the worst gift they could ever got. So anyway, the other thing about this thing called pride, which has I as its center, is it doesn't only keep you from all those things I just mentioned, but it causes you to do some other things. It causes you to feel good when someone else fails. That makes me cry. It really does. Like, let's be honest and open and transparent, is when someone's getting something that you don't feel they deserve, it's hard to be happy for them. But let's go to the opposite, is that when they don't do well or they fail at something, there's something inside of us that's like, well, good. Like, you know, Dave, am I lying? If I'm lying, I'm dying. Okay. This thing called pride, it also causes you to power up instead of opening up. It causes you to cheat instead of lose. It causes you to lie about your past, your failed marriage, or the fact, in my case, that you never graduated from high school. Okay, I did graduate from high school. I never graduated from college, but I've been telling everybody that I did, and that was totally rooted in the fact that I didn't want you to think that I wasn't what I needed you to think I was. Does that make sense to you? Okay, pride also causes you to have the final word. And maybe you can get that from the show. Like, I always have to have the final word. And then it causes you to buy stuff. Causes you to buy stuff to impress other people. Like, Dave, I don't judge you as someone who's prideful. I don't know. Is that something that you might struggle with ever? I guess we all in some case or another? Okay, so I'm establishing straight up front, this isn't about being proud that your kid did something, that your family is enjoying and celebrating something, or you work for a company that's had great success. That kind of pride inspires people to greatness. I'm talking about the kind of pride that minimizes, that puts down, that objectifies, that pride that the greatest, this is a scripture verse, anger, greed, drunkenness are mere flea bites in comparison to pride, because pride is what leads to every other sin. So that's major, Dave. Like, you can just put pride at the highest possible level. And the deal is, everyone in my family, for some reason or another, on my actual birthday, could have justifiably said, I'm not writing mom a letter. And for all the reasons, they could have not done that, and it would have been justifiable in their mind. And I'm so grateful that there was this some twinge of God's grace and humility that allowed all of them to not lower themselves, but submit themselves to doing something that they didn't feel they had to, that they should, or that they wanted to do, because it spoke volumes to me, and it's the only thing I have to go on as a parent, Dave, especially with this year that we're coming off of. But this thing about pride is it's ugly. It's the ugliest thing ever. And the other thing is we can see it so clearly in other people, but it's literally invisible. We cannot see it in the mirror. We look in a mirror, but if you lined up the 2-3 billion people in the whole world, 2 billion of them would say, oh yeah, I can see that in you, but you can't see it in yourself. So here's the thing about pride. It has this false sense of puffing us up. It has this false sense of making us feel like we're bigger, better, smarter, prettier, more successful, more. But in reality, when you're watching someone who's full of themselves in terms of pride, it totally makes them smaller, Dave, doesn't it? It really, it doesn't make us bigger. It absolutely diminishes us. And what it does is it diminishes our ability to admit, to apologize, or to acknowledge. It diminishes our ability to say what needs to be said, like to compliment someone, to praise them. It diminishes our ability to hear what needs to be heard. And most importantly, it diminishes our ability to give what needs to be given. Okay, so I'm the first to admit that the biggest room in our house is the room for improvement, and that you need to take my advice since I'm not using it, because I just did this the other morning when my man came down the stairs and I pretended like I was sleeping because I was so mad at him from what had happened the day before, right? That I was not willing, listen to me, I was not willing to admit, to apologize, or to acknowledge. I was not willing to say what needed to be said, to hear what needed to be heard, and most importantly, to give what needed to be given. Because pride does not make you bigger and better. Pride makes you smaller and worse. I am living proof of that. So what do we got to do? We got to kill it. Let's talk about that when we return. Thanks to Cunis Country Auto Group for sponsoring Journey with Judy. Don't close your eyes. Don't close your eyes. This is your life. Are you who you want to be? This is your life. All right, so Switchfoot asked the question three times because he knows that, you know, they just know that I need to hear the same question three times. Like, this is your life. Are you who you're supposed to be? Are you who you're supposed to be? This is your life. Is it everything you dreamed it would be? And I think for many of us, if we were going to be honest, open, and transparent, we would say no, like a big fat no. It's not what I thought. I'm not who I should be. I'm not who I could be. And I'm not who I would be if my first thought every morning was to keep my eyes fixed on God, and every thought thereafter throughout the day was to stay fixed on God, and every night if I ended my evening with a daily inventory of the countless blessings that God just bestows on us that we don't even realize, like if I was doing all those things, I'm pretty sure that it would be the life that I dreamed of. It would be that I would be all I'm supposed to be. And I just don't believe that wouldn't be the same for everybody, Dave. And maybe some of my listeners can relate to the fact that when you want to get to that place in your life where you are all that you are created to be, it's not easy. There's like so much suffering involved. And so it's so funny because my life is just a mass of contradictions. I'm so not who I, you know, people think I am. And I'm really willing to just admit that to everybody. It's a journey and not a destination. And no one struggles more with the journey than the host of the show. But on the bottom of my email and my signature, it has Romans 5:3-4. Now, that verse, for those of you who don't know, it says, we rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance produces character, and character produces hope. And so that's so funny because I so don't do that. I never read. No, I don't, Dave. Like, I mean, I told you my kids see me and they're like, what's wrong? The kids call me Hag now. H-A-G. Hag. What's up, Hag? They think I'm a hag. Like, aren't they mean? Dave, are my kids so mean? Answer, yes. They're brutal. Like, it's just, and you know what? That makes me really sad because I think that some people would say my kids are very respectful. They're just not very, very respectful to me. But they would be that way to you. You know what I'm saying? So who we are when nobody's looking is really who we are. And so who I am is someone who really struggles with admitting truth, really struggles with accepting truth, and even struggles the most with acting on that truth. And so I love this verse today about Romans saying, like, here's the deal. We rejoice because we know that at the end of the day, God is going to deliver. And maybe even more importantly, if you make it about you like I do, is I'm going to be able to persevere. I'm going to have more character and I'm going to have more hope because that's the promise. And we said last week, forget about the process. Focus on the promise because the promise is always that there's light at the end of the tunnel, and it's not really a freight train every time, Dave. Just some of the time it's a freight train, right? But God is always on time. I mean, it just might seem like he's a little late for some of us, but he's always on perfect time.
He's on his time.
On his time. And I hate that, too. I hate that God is not on my time schedule, Dave, and I hate that I can't control everything that's going to happen. But see, here's what I do know. I do know. Dave, I just thought of something. Today's my birthday. Oh, my gosh, I just realized that. So I'm 59 years old today. No, 49. 40. I'm 49 years old today. No, because my kids said I was 60, but I'm not. Okay, I just thought of that. Okay, so happy birthday to me. Yeah, there was a time where I really wanted all of you to wish me happy birthday, but at this time we'll probably just...
Are you getting your letters when you get home?
I better get a lot more than some letters. I better get some respect. I know Aretha Franklin said I deserve it, and I think I do deserve it. But anyway, okay, so here's the deal. So sometimes for me, what happens is some setback. Oh, my gosh, I only have not a lot of time left. Oh, my gosh. Okay. So something happens, and we call that a setback. But if we're people of faith and we're journeying with Judy, then we're reminded every Sunday that a setback is a step up for a comeback. And so we can't let the setback keep us back. We got to keep moving forward. We got to keep taking steps, staying focused and fixed on God and being honest, open, and transparent, which is just admitting truth, not your truth, God's truth. Accepting truth, not your truth, God's truth. And acting on that very truth that God is who he says, he does what he says, you are who he says, and you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. So just buck up and deal with it, Dave, and quit complaining like me. Stop whining and complaining and start believing and receiving because God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. Thanks for choosing to journey with Judy this morning. And if you're not gonna admit, accept, and act, well, then at least keep it hot, honest, open, and transparent. Peace out, and happy birthday to me!